Good morning. I'm Carol Hunter, politics editor at the Des Moines Register, and welcome to the Des Moines Register Political Soapbox. Our next speaker is Congressman Dave Loebsack in the 2nd District. He's a Democrat from Iowa City, and he's seeking his 5th term. His opponent is Marionette Miller Meeks. She's a Republican from Ottumwa. Congressman Loebsack.
Thank you, Carol. Thanks, Carol. We all like those short introductions, right? Hey, really great to be here. My wife Terry is with me today. She's going to be here most of the day. I'm going to be here almost all the day as well. I've got some other things I have to do, but it's wonderful to be here at the State Fair. I've done this a number of times as a candidate, and as a candidate, then as a congressman, and I just think it's a great opportunity for folks to hear what we have to say about the issues and hopefully make a more informed choice than might otherwise be the case. Also, I know a lot of the speakers talk about what an institution the Iowa State Fair is, and you know, as a native Iowan, as somebody who grew up in Sioux City, there I see an Iowa State shirt or two here. I went to Iowa State, although I represent the Hawkeyes in Congress now, but I got them both covered. As somebody who is a lifelong Iowan, it means a lot to me to be here at the State Fair. The first time I was ever here was in the summer of 1969. Terry and I were listening to the radio on the way down. I said, oh, that song was playing incessantly, you know, when I was at the State Fair in 1969. And I camped out with a friend right over here on the hill. And it was really wonderful. Look, you got a lot of big decisions that you have to make this fall. There's no question about it. And it's going to be easier in some cases than in others. But you know, the fact of the matter is, the country is still recovering very slowly from the economy. The middle class is under tremendous pressure. We all know that. The middle class has really, in some ways, been on the decline for a lot of years. And a lot of people have fallen out of the middle class over the years. Some have gotten back into it. A lot have never been in the middle class and have never gotten into it. That sort of brings me to, you know, who I am and where I came from and why I do the best I can to fight for the middle class and why I focus on the middle class. Many of you here probably have no idea how I grew up in Sioux City. I grew up with a single parent mom, and there were 4 kids in our household, and she struggled with mental illness and she had an 11th grade education. So we didn't have anything to speak of growing up. And I decided at a pretty early age that I was gonna get a good education, I was gonna try to be as responsible as I could be, and hopefully never live in poverty as an adult. And I've been very lucky that I haven't had to do that. I haven't done this on my own. I had a lot of people along the way who helped me out. The importance of community, I think, is something we can't stress too much. I had a high school principal who came to me my senior year and said, Dave, I know you're going to be going to Iowa State. I know it's not been an easy time. We've got this janitor's job here this summer. If you'd like to have that job, you can have that job. And then if you do a good job this summer, you can do it every summer while you're at Iowa State. You can do it during those Christmas vacations, get a little extra money. And I said to him, thank you very much, Mr. Farrell. I appreciate that. I took advantage of that opportunity, and that's exactly what I did to get myself through college. I did a lot of other things too, worked a lot of other jobs. But that's what I did, and I pulled myself up. But I couldn't have done it without Gene Farrell. I couldn't have done it without the Social Security survivor benefits that I received after my dad died when I was in high school. I couldn't have done it if we had not moved in with my grandma in the 4th grade, and she was getting Social Security survivor benefits. I couldn't have done it without any of that. Sure, I worked hard and I pulled myself up, but I didn't do it all by myself. And that's what I try to take with me and carry with me every day that I go to Congress, is remembering how it was for me and how I got to where I am today. Because we've got so many folks like that. And as I said, a lot of folks who were in the middle class and have fallen out of the middle class over the years. We got Max Tipton from Newton here. Newton has had it rough. We know that. We saw what happened with Maytag and Whirlpool. They're coming back because they've got some good investments there. But There are so many things that we can do to protect the middle class and shore up the middle class and make sure that folks who've never been in it get in it. You know, I have a big focus on education. A lot of you know that. I taught at Cornell College for 24 years, and my wife, Terry, was a second grade school teacher for over 30 years. Education comes naturally to me, but it doesn't come naturally to everybody. And focusing on education has to be a key to all of this. This is something I think that we can agree on a bipartisan basis, something we all know doesn't happen in Washington, D.C. very often, right? I think we can agree on that. Also, when we talk about the middle class, we've got to talk about getting people back to work, and we've got to talk about job training and workforce development, and education dovetails quite nicely with that, as you know. Just recently, we passed the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Grant Act. It was passed on a bipartisan basis in the Congress. It was passed on a bicameral basis. Senator Harkin worked really hard on that. I worked hard on that. I'm on the relevant committee. It's about making sure that folks who need the workforce training so they can get those jobs that are out there, and there are some jobs out there where the employers can't find folks with the necessary skills. It's about making sure that we can match up folks with the skills for the jobs that are available. And I'm really proud of the fact that I worked for a number of years on something called My Sectors Act. And that's exactly what this is about, folks. Making sure that individuals can get the education and get the training they need so they can get those jobs. My Sectors Act, large portions of it, got into that bill. That's something I'm doing every day working for the middle class. I'm proud of that accomplishment, folks, and we're going to keep working as hard as we can to implement that bill, work on those community colleges, make sure that folks get the education they need and the training skills they need. That's absolutely critical, folks, absolutely critical. And look, while we're talking about the middle class, you know, this campaign is going to hinge also in no small measure on how candidates look at Social Security and Medicare and the positions they take on those two programs. I think everyone here can agree, whether you're a Republican or a Democrat or an independent or whatever you may be, a libertarian, that Medicare and Social Security are the two greatest anti-poverty programs in the history of this country. There's no question about that. Seniors stay in the middle class in no small measure because of those two programs. Now, there are folks on the other side who want to privatize Social Security. They want to put Social Security at the risk of the stock market and risky investments. There are folks who want to voucherize Medicare. I want to ask those who are 65 and over, who might be on Medicare, do you really believe that if the federal government wrote you a check for $600 or even $700, that you could somehow go out on the private insurance market and get coverage that you now get under Medicare? Does anybody believe that?
No!
No way, there's no way. That's what the Ryan budget is about. That's what my opponent and others want to see happen. Voucherize Medicare. I've never been for that, folks. I've never been for privatization of Social Security. I never will be for those two things. Never, folks. A lot of other differences between my opponent. We're going to flesh those out as we go along. You know, one of the things I do want to mention, you know, Congress is an incredibly dysfunctional mess right now, and everybody knows that because the partisanship is really pretty horrendous there. And it's mostly at the leadership level. I see we've got folks here from No Labels. That is absolutely fantastic. I'm a part of that group. That group says that we don't care whether you're Republican or Democrat. If you have the right ideas, we want to work with you. And that's what I do on a regular basis. I couldn't have gotten My Sectors Act into that bigger bill if I had not sat down for breakfast with the Republican chair of the subcommittee that dealt with that issue and convinced her that my bill was the right thing to do. I couldn't have done that if I had not talked to the other side of the aisle. We couldn't have gotten the most recent Veterans Administration bill through if we had not worked across the aisle. if we had not done things in this state across the aisle. We couldn't have had the flood recovery if Chuck Grassley and I had not worked together on those tax breaks and those Midwest disaster relief bonds in 2008. We wouldn't have the wind power here in America if it had not been initially for Chuck Grassley and then for Steve King and I doing everything we can together to make sure that that production tax credit gets extended for 3 to 5 years. That's the kind of bipartisanship that I'm talking about. And the Farm Bill, Iowa's delegation worked hard on that Farm Bill to get that passed. I'm not on the Agriculture Committee, folks, but I worked my tail off to do what I could to make sure that that bill got through, that it works for farmers, that it works for all those industries connected to the farming industry here in America. And that was done on a bipartisan basis. And one last one, the renewable fuel standard. Everyone practically, I think, who's been up here, I didn't hear all the speeches, but probably almost everyone who's running for federal office is talking about the RFS. I've had 2 meetings with White House officials, another third one informally when I was wearing my button at the White House that said, don't mess with the RFS, okay? This is a big deal. But we've done that on a bipartisan basis, not just in Iowa, but around the country. That's the kind of thing that I'm talking about, folks. And that's the kind of thing that I'm going to continue to do so long as I'm in Congress. I ask for your help. I ask for your support. I ask for your vote. Thank you so much to the Des Moines Register and Carol and all the others for having us here. 84 days to go, but as I like to say, who's counting except the candidates and their family, right? Thanks, everybody. Have a great state fair. Really appreciate it.